أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على محمد وآله الطاهرين Dear sisters and brothers in Iman, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We are into the last week of the holy month of Ramadan, the month of blessings, mercy and forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Based on the astronomical calculations, we expect the Eid al-Fitr to be on Thursday. However, wait for the confirmation of the actual sighting on Wednesday night, inshallah. Fasting is not just simply a spiritual exercise for individuals. It also has an important social dimension in which we can relate to the suffering and difficulties and challenges that others face in the society. The message of the social dimension is actually embedded in the fasting itself. When the rich people go through the process of fasting, they can relate to the suffering of the poor and the needy. This social dimension is also embedded in the du'as that we have from the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt, where they emphasize this point that pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the prayer should also be a way of seeking ways to improve the situation of those who are in need and those who are suffering. For example, if you look at the famous du'a that we have from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is highly recommended during the month of Ramadan, that it should be recited after every wajib prayers. There we see that the Prophet actually talks about the social dimension of the fasting of the month of Ramadan. The dua begins with the words, Allahumma adkhil ala ahli al-qubur al-surur. So basically we can divide the phases, the passages of the dua into four or five. The first one, where the Prophet is saying that, you know, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant peace and tranquility and surur and happiness and joy to those who have passed away. So the first dua is not to forget the deceased members of your family, your relatives, your friends, the community at large. Remember them in your prayers. Then immediately we come to the second category, where the Prophet says, Allahumma aghni kulla faqir, Allahumma ashba kulla ja'i, Allahumma aksa kulla uriyan, Allahumma aghza dayna kulla madin, Allahumma farrijan kulla makroob. Five types of situation have been discussed, where we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, to relieve the poor person from poverty, you know, to feed the hungry people, to provide decent clothing for those who don't have that, and to fulfill the debts of those who are in debt, and also to relieve people who are in distress. Now, it's important to realize that this dua can not only be a dua and a prayer, that you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do that. The theme that we see in the du'as from the Imams of Ahlul Bayt is taught by the Prophet himself here in this case, that you don't only pray to Allah to do things, you actually should see whether you become the link in the chain and the wasita in solving the difficult situations of the people. You know, so this concept of becoming a wasita and a wasila, the link in the chain of solutions. The first three are very easy when we talk about faqir and jai' and uryan, you know, to relieve the people from their poverty. The other two are more difficult when you talk about the people who are in debt and the people who are in distress. That needs more extra, you know, realization of the situations and verification. Then we come to the third passage of that dua from the Prophet, where we say, Allahumma rudda kulla ghareeb, Allahumma fukka kulla asir, Allahumma aslih kulla fasidin min umuri al-Muslimin. Three items here. Number one, O Allah, you know, take the stranded traveler or the refugees, if I may use the current term, safely to their homes. O Allah, you know, grant the release and freedom to those who are in prison, just because of their conscience and their belief and their faith. And Allah put every wrong thing in the affairs of the Muslims, put it right, islah, reform it. In this category, we come to realize that, you know, when we talk about a gharib, here a gharib is in the sense of the refugees of the modern times. When we talk about asir, those who are in prison because of their faith or their conscience. And this is where we have to realize that we have a duty not only to pray for them, we have to see what we can do as far as our part in resolving their problems. When we talk about Muslim community in the West, we need to look for means and ways by which we can shift the public opinion on these issues and draw the attention of our governments and human rights organizations, especially about Muslim minorities who are put under distress because of political strife and conflict. In this regard, you know, the issue of the Palestinians, the issue of Houthis in Yemen, the Rohingya in Myanmar, these issues should be given top priority. They are the most oppressed and forgotten people at the moment. The plight of the Palestinian is an important issue for all people of conscience, Muslims and non-Muslims alike. Even when the Pope visited the Grand Ayatullah as-Sistani in Najaf, the Ayatollah talked about this issue and emphasized the role of the religious leaders in that they should be playing in curbing these tragedies and to urge the great powers to prefer reason and wisdom over the language of war, and to promote and not to promote their self-interest over the rights of the people to live in freedom and dignity in their own region with their own values and their faith. Ayatollah as-Sistani talked about, and based on the statement which came from his office, and we talked about it 2 months ago at that time, you know, he says the injustice, oppression, religious and intellectual persecution, suppression of basic freedoms, and the absence of social justice are the issues for the religious leaders to think about. Especially he highlighted the plight of the Palestinians, where he says acts of violence, economic blockage, and displacement of the Palestinian people in the occupied territories are a matter of concern for us and for all religious people around the world. It's important to realize that the Grand Ayatollah was purely talking from the religious and moral stand, as he does not hold any political office. But his counterpart, the Pope, was not only the religious leader of the Catholics around the world, but he is also the head of the Vatican State. And perhaps this was a way of conveying the message that you as a head of the state should talk with the great powers, you know, to follow what is known as wisdom and reason and not the language of war. So raise your voice for the oppressed Palestinian children, women and men, whom even the Arab governments these days have abandoned for the sake of their own self-interest. And that is why after the statement of Ayatollah as-Sistani was released regarding his meeting with the Pope, Mahmoud Abbas, the president of Palestine, publicly thanked the Grand Ayatollah to highlight the plight of the Palestinians. Of course, we have to join with the people of conscience, especially in our own countries, and do things according to the laws of the land. Next, we come to the item in the dua where the Prophet is saying, Allahumma shfi kulla mariz. It's a prayer for those who are sick, especially during this pandemic that we are going through. It is very appropriate, you know, to pray that may the Almighty protect humanity at large from the problem of coronavirus and grant fast and speedy recovery to those who are suffering because of that. And this is where we have to pray for all human beings in general, especially during the remaining days of the holy month of Ramadan, for kulla mariv. Finally, we come to the passage where the Prophet says, now pray for yourself. And this style in the du'as of the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt is very common, where they say, pray for others before you pray for yourself. Al-jar thumma ad-dar. This is what Fatima al-Zahra salawatullah alayha said to Imam Hassan. When Imam Hassan was still very young, and he said to the mother, that I see whenever you pray about others first before you pray for yourself. And this is where Fatima al-Zahra uttered these words, al-jar thumma ad-dar. We pray for others before we pray for ourselves. And so at the end, the Prophet says, you know, pray for yourself. Allahumma sudda faqrana bighinaq. O Allah, you know, relieve us of poverty and need by your ghina. You are self-sufficient. Allahumma ghayyir su'a halina bihusni halik. O Allah, you are always the best. You know, change our situation. Change the worst which is there into good. Allahumma ghdi anna ad-dayn. O Allah, whatever debts that we have, you know, make us free from the debts. وَغْنِنَا مِنَ الْفَاقِرِ, and provide for us so that we will not be in need of anyone. At the end, normally the du'as end with these words, إِنَّكَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. You indeed have power to do everything. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may He give us the wisdom to understand the social dimension of the fasting of the month of Ramadan, and fulfill our duty in the best possible manner. Everybody has to look at their own circumstances and fulfill their duty accordingly. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep you all under His protection, and may He hasten the appearance of the Imam of our time, ajjalallahu ta'ala faraj al-sharif. Be safe and keep others safe. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.